enjoyed the break, little break that you got. So we were looking at lists. Within that, we were looking at specialized form of list called queue. And we have not really looked at the implementation, but we know by now how the list is likely to get implemented. And therefore, we were trying to play around with the ADT with a certain algorithm. In this case, instead of an algorithm like in balanced parenthesis case, we said that we'll look at a more elaborate application. And that application is a simulation of a call center in which there are certain number of operators, which are agents, which are going to serve the customer request, and there are certain number of customers. If the number of customers is smaller than the number of operators, then it's okay. They can, no customer needs to wait for when they call a particular operator, when they call the call center. But if the number of customers is large, then there is a waiting that the customers need to experience, and this waiting can be logically implemented like a queue, so that it's kind of a fair thing. Whosoever calls first should get the first priority to get an free operator. And this kind of simulation is what we would like to what we were discussing last time. And let me just complete this discussion on the slide, and then we are going to look at, okay, I think, yeah. So the simulation is based on time, which means that there are discrete time units at which different actions are occurring. So either a new user can arrive, a free operator can be assigned to a user, right? If no operator is free, then the user needs to wait. That means he or she gets pushed into a waiting queue. At some point in time, a busy operator can become free, and therefore that free operator can be assigned to a user. Or nothing happens, which means that no new user is joining, no busy operator becomes free, but then whatever are the busy operators, their waiting, their engaging time kind of reduces, right? And our simulation needs to bunch these together. So let me share that code now. But any questions before we move on? Okay, so let's look at this code. So we require, okay, before getting into the code, we also ran it once, but let me run it again, right? So call center input is the one, and we were also looking at the indirection operator input and output, where 5 is the number of operators in the call center. And then 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 4, 6, 5. These are all IDs of the customers, right? And then this is the amount of time that they all require, each of them requires whenever they call the call center. I have also used the value 0 just to make things kind of work even with a 0 value. But typically, this is going to be a non-zero value. Which essentially means that these need not even be queued. Five, something like that, and accordingly the output will also change. So we had compiled this and then run it, but while running, I need to give input call center input.txt, and then it starts with a simulation, which is discrete time steps, and then what all actions happen at different times that we need to analyze, right? So that we'll analyze based on the input, at least a few of these, and then we'll see. But essentially, time 10 is where nothing happens, only the user 6 is assigned to an operator, and no other user exists, and therefore the waiting time of user 6 to whatever is the operator that he or she is assigned with, in this case 1, that waiting time reduces, right? And then there are other actions happening at different places. Okay, so let's look at the code. We have a queue ADT, which is coming from the STL list ADT, which is also coming from STL. UNISTD is required just for that sleeping, right? So you must have seen that the simulation looks like it is happening in discrete steps of 1 second each. So that I have used sleep as the waiting time. So that is provided in UNISTD.h. There is an operator, there is a user, and both of them are uniquely identified with an ID, which is an integer ID in this case, but it can be an arbitrary structure. We have not really gone into a very elaborate implementation of this call center, but you get the idea out of this. Then we have a structure which defines the mapping between the customer and the operator. And that mapping is stored inside something called as a busy operator. The name is about the operator, but essentially that means that there is an operator as well as a user who are paired together. And whatever is the remaining time, because we would like to at every step reduce that time, that is also stored as part of this structure. So these are three independent entities bunched together inside the aggregate or a structure. You could also make it a class, doesn't matter, just that there were no functions, so I just made those as struct. And then there are certain functions which we need to worry about. And note that there is no class which is implemented as such, where there is a class and then there are member functions. You can do that. You can have a class call center, and within that all of these functions could be there. And that is also, that is probably a better way to organize this. But since this was a single application, I didn't bother to do that. But ideally, when you are developing an application where this call center might be a part of a larger umbrella of project, in that case, it's better to put all these functions into a class. Any questions so far? Okay, so let's look at main first, so that we come to know about the flow, what all is happening, etc. So we have number of operators, which is coming from the input. So that is what we read here. Then we have a queue of operators, because we said that the operators should also be inside a queue so that we don't overburden a particular operator. And then there is a busy operator list, which I need to maintain. Now, I am maintaining it as a list, but you might want to maintain it as a sorted array, sorted list, something else, right? To make sure that I am updating the, let's say, whichever operator reaches the time of zero, I should be able to remove those easily, right? So those complexity notions will come into picture depending upon what data structure we use here for busy operators. Right? So here we are just using the list. So whichever are busy operators with a particular user, their waiting goes on reducing. And whenever it reaches zero, I am removing that element from this list. So since at every time step, all the elements in this list need to be looked at, therefore, it makes sense to have it as a list. There is no real reason to have it a more complicated data structure. It could be an array also. But if I have to remove an element from the array, I need to shift. And therefore, complexity of removal will become order n. Whereas in this case, since it's a list and doubly linked list, therefore you're able to remove an element in order one time, because you are already at that element. You are not searching for an operator having zero waiting time. So that becomes an advantageous part of implementing it as a linked list. Definitely, can we have other, let's say, data structures which we could use here, and what are the implications of how the time complexity changes, etc. So we read the number of operators, and then we need to read which user wants how much time of the operator from the call center. So that information also we need to read. So that we will keep reading, and until that happens, we are going to keep reading. In this case, it's from the input, you can read it. Okay, so the initialization needs to make sure that we have a queue of free operators, right? So at some point in time, there are some busy operators and then there are some free operators. So if you think at the initial part, the busy operators list is empty, and therefore the free operators list should contain all the operators. So that is what is the invariant that we maintain, and free operators should be inserted all the n operators, 0 to n. So that is what we do in case of any FOP is, I think, free operators. Okay, so there are some variables which we need. So there is an OR required, and somebody can tell me why we require such a different thing. I mean, even if there is, I mean, why shouldn't we just process all the entries? Why should we require some additional condition? Can somebody think about that based on whatever we have seen so far? The question is, why we require the second condition in pipe? Sorry, is my audio everybody? Oh man, I'm very sorry. Yeah, I'm not again on reliable network, so that's probably the reason why my audio is breaking. But I'll try to come closer to the mic, closer to the laptop. Okay, that's a good suggestion. I'll try switching off the video. I think that will probably help save some bandwidth. Let's see how it helps. Okay, but my question is that why do we require a busy operator? That second condition, busy operators dot empty. Aniruddha says it can be dereferenced inside loop. I didn't quite understand that, but yeah, that is true. No, I'm not asking about that busy operators should be having this particular check. I'm more asking from the logical perspective that while I'm reading the inputs, only then I should go ahead and process, right? Why do I need to have another condition there? Mayank is saying at some moment of time we don't have incoming users, but there might some call going on, right? So that is correct. So we have, let's say, even if there is one entry in the input file, that entry might have a large call time, and that call time we need to simulate. Even if there are 5 steps required, we need to simulate all those 5 steps where that particular user's time will go on reducing. Therefore, we require 5 steps to be simulated. Therefore, while loop should have 5 iterations. And therefore, we require that second condition. And note that it is not a condition of AND. It is a condition on OR. And therefore, there will be at least as many steps as the number of lines in the file, and maybe more. All right. So at every time step, we just print whatever is the time step. And then at that time, whatever are the operations that are happening, we just simulate those. So what are those operations? If the time is greater than 0, right? So this U time, as I mentioned, could be 0 just to for the check that it is working from the input. Because since this is coming from the input, that is also an important point, that whatever is coming externally from the user, from the network, from a file, all of these are external inputs. And we have to make sure that your program works irrespective of how the external environment is, because those can change arbitrarily. That is not in the hands of you as a programmer. Whereas there is some variable which is coming from a particular function, a particular caller, you can make some adjustments in the code such that that variable will always be within this range and so on. So therefore, your program should be input proof in a real world setting, right? When you go to a point. So therefore, all these checks are actually important. I mean, we should always check that the user time is greater than 0. I also have suggested that it can also be used as a skip, which means that you just don't want to do anything, but can be specified as a user input as a skip. You just want to skip at that time. You don't want to do anything. Right? More like kind of holiday in between, right? In our academic calendar. Okay. So if that user time is more, then we try to identify if there is a free operator. Okay. Here, let's see if that free operator is going to be available or not, because not always there will be a free operator. Correct. So how does this work? Because I just get the free operator, make that operator busy, and then I am just pushing it into busy operators. Doesn't that mean that I am assuming that the free operator list always contains at least one operator? Doesn't this sound a little odd? Any suggestions here? Why would you always get a free operator? I mean, it looks like that, at least here, right? That doesn't seem all right. Okay, so the implementation of free operators will help us do that. We'll come to that in a while. So I have this sleep call, which just waits for a minute, waits for a second. And after that, then there are actions. I mean, one of the actions has already occurred, that based on the input, I'm marking a particular user with a operator. So that free operator becomes busy. That is going to be removed from free operator, pushed into the busy operator list, right? Okay. Then for each of these operators which are there inside the busy list, I need to reduce their waiting time by one. Right? So that's what we do. We have an iterator which is going over the list of busy operators. So that iterator is called as BOP. So this is similar to, as I was mentioning, int ii equal to 0, ii less than busy operators dot size, ii plus plus, right? And then we say BOP equal to busy operators array index ii. So this can be written in that way also, but this is more, let's say, more uniform way of handling it across all aggregates. So I reduce the busy operator with a remaining time using this minus minus, and if that happens to be zero, right, then I need to do something, that is the remove it from the free operator, because now the customer's waiting time is not required, it has become zero. So I'll come to that. Otherwise, I just need to increase the BOP, right? So that I have not done as part of the for loop, BOP plus plus, because that BOP plus plus might not be required in this part. Because I'm removing the element, so therefore the BOP will be pointing to the next element. So that's why only in if the waiting time is non-zero, then only you require this BOP plus plus. So if it is zero, then I remove that particular operator from the busy operators, that is here, and push it to the free operators. Right? So I'm just doing it in the opposite order. So that part is okay. Then new time equal to zero, which is essentially just redefining that, because sometimes if you have not specified the other value, then new time might not get initialized at all, right? So if there are no further entries, then it might not get initialized, and therefore you might end up doing something wrong, right? So therefore that new time equal to zero is crucial, right? Because you will go inside the loop even if this condition is true. Right. So therefore, you should be a little careful about that part. That can be mistakenly not added. Okay. Any questions so far? Is the voice still breaking? Okay, good. So Anish is asking, what is colon colon iterator? So colon colon is a scope resolution operator, which means that there is a class called list of busy operators. So there is a class list. It's a templatized class using which you can create different kinds of lists, lists of integer, list of character, lists of some arbitrary structure like busy operator, etc. Inside that, there is an iterator field, iterator type, which is defined. What does that type do? Its job is to go over different elements of this list, this particular class. So colon colon iterator means that it's like an index, or think about it as like a pointer, which is going to point to different elements as you do plus plus that operator, plus plus that iterator. In this case, BOP is the variable name. So BOP plus plus means that it is going to point to the second element, first element, then second element, and then so on. So begin and end are specialized functions which are provided by all the aggregates that returns an iterator or a pointer. Think about it like a pointer, but pointer is not the exact term, because these iterators are actually objects. There is a class called iterator. It's a type. Is it predefined in STL? Yes, it is predefined in all of the STLs. And you can also define, if you define an a class which is like an aggregate, let's say you are storing all the elements of, let's say all the students in a class or all the elements inside a particle physics simulation, then you can define your own iterator also, right? And then somebody can write let's say my class dot begin, my class dot end, and so on. So all of this is possible. Okay, Sai Charan says, what does while scene do? It's more like while, not of file pointer, right? So that we use in C. It's essentially going to go over until that scene, if it finds something to read, it reads. If it doesn't find, then it returns zero value. So that, or something which is equivalent to a zero value. And that zero value we can utilize just to read according to the number of lines in the file. So like you do while minus I, right? So that is what you initialize it to n, then while minus I. So that will iterate n number of times. In a similar manner, this will just read from the input, and in this case, the input is coming from a file. So as soon as end of file comes, this stops. When you are giving input from like your hand, at that time, you can press Control D to specify the end of the file in Linux environments. In Windows, I don't know. Any other concerns? All right. So let's look at this part, that we felt that it's a little odd that you will always find a free operator, right? So logically, it doesn't seem to make sense. Let's identify that, and we'll come to, okay, maybe we'll go function by function. So we have make busy operator, essentially is going to add one structure of this busy operator, one node into this list. So this free operator needs to be assigned to this user, and this is their initial time. So that's what we create, one busy operator, right? This is a structure. Dot op is the free operator, dot user is the user, whatever is given, and remaining time is u time, right? So that is what is essentially, and then I return that from make busy operator. Now this is a local variable and this is being returned. Does that create a problem? Right? Busy operator is a local variable inside make busy operator. When we return it from the function, does that create a problem, or why doesn't it create a problem? It returns the value in BOP. Yes, so the structures are returned by value, structures are also returned by value, and therefore it's just going to make a copy. It's not going to do anything with respect to the memory of busy operator inside make busy operator function. So therefore we are safe. It's like returning an integer value, right, in this context. Okay, so that is good. Now let's, okay, so that our FOP init was essentially go over 0 to n number of operators and add that free operator, the ID of that free operator, which is 0 to n minus 1 or 0 to n operators minus 1 into the free operator. So that was our initial, right? Okay, let's talk about the get free operators. What does get free operator do is that if the free operator list is not empty, if the free operator's queue rather is not empty, then I'm going to return the first element into this from this queue, that is front followed by pop, which is going to just dequeue an element from the start of the list, start of the queue, and I'm returning. Otherwise, I'm doing nothing. And that seems a little odd because this expects something to be written. Doesn't this mean that this is going to probably cause some problem? Okay, so it should cause a problem, and in general this is not the best way to write a code and show you all with error processing, etc. This is more like the usual logic, and then there is additional error processing that we need to do to make sure that that works, right? So let me, so the first callcenter.cpp is actually the code which works without any waiting time, right? So if there is, there are enough number of operators, then no user needs to wait. So we essentially don't need that to maintain any queue of waiting users, right? So that is how that callcenter.cpp works. Callcenter2.cpp takes into account the other part also, and there you will see that all of this is going to, for example, this make waiting user, this function is not present in the first version, so it doesn't work with waiting users. Okay, but here also I think I have get free operator is returning nothing, but I think that check is happening here. Okay, so free operators, if it is not empty, then only we get into this, right? So one of the, as we discussed, one of the two is going to be free, either the waiting users or the free operators, right? So both of them can't be occupied at the same time, and in that case we'll be able to make use of that the free operators list is not empty, and therefore we can where is that here also doesn't seem to be I'm doing anything with respect to the free operator check, right? So that seems a little odd. I am check will come back to this. Let's go back to our code of where there is no waiting for the users, right? So this call center dot cpp, so that was our get free operator, which has this issue that the operator might not be free, right? So it should not return anything really, but in this case this assumption is valid that there are no waiting users, so therefore this will never happen, so that part is okay. And then there is main, so there isn't anything further in this. And let's try to, oh, that's the reason why we require call center input to have those values zero, right? So there should not be any waiting. Okay, this is more like a skip, so I'll just use that. And this actually we have executed, so that is okay. Okay, so then let's come to callcenter2.cpp, and if you look at callcenter input 2, I mean callcenter2.cpp will work with callcenter input.txt also, but it will also work with input 2, which is going to have a larger waiting time, sorry, larger kind of connection time, busy time, and therefore you are going to have some sort of a waiting for the users, waiting for the customers. So this will work with both of them, but I think that make busy that free operators list we have to worry about a little bit. Okay, so here we have a busy operator as well as a waiting user. Right? What does a waiting user indicate? Well, that means which user is waiting and how much is its remaining time. Remaining time meaning the time with which that user has come in. Right? Whatever we have read from the input that we need to store somewhere. So each user, in some sense, if all the operators are busy, it's going to directly go into the waiting queue. You can actually decide that irrespective of whether an operator is free or not, you can just directly push a user into a waiting user, right? And then the your application, the while loop, is going to remove elements from this waiting user list and assign some free operator to this waiting user if it exists. Okay, so make busy operators remains the same. Make waiting user is also going to be very similar, where waiting user is going to whatever is the user and the remaining time is whatever is the U time that you have read from the input. FOP init remains the same. Get free operator also remains the same, and I'm still concerned about that, but let me see if I get something interesting. So there is a list of busy operators that we had earlier, and there is a queue of waiting users now in this second version of the code. This also gives you a glimpse of how the code should be developed. Initially, you can relax certain restrictions, or you need not implement all the parts. Here, call center dot CPP, the first version, did not work with waiting users. You assume that there are enough number of operators, and that can be a good check, because initially you can modify the input such that there is no waiting, right? And then you can add the into the implementation, right? So that is also another way in which you can make sure that the existing functionality, whatever is expected, you need not implement everything at one go. You need to do testing part by part, right? So that you are confident of, okay, this part of the code works, right? At least some test cases will pass, right? Like that. So develop it in that manner. Right, so in this case, free operators, if it is not empty, then we get into this part where we are guaranteed to get a free operator, as well as there are some waiting users, right? So then that means that those waiting users, we need to move, we need to find some free operator, right? So if we push whenever the input comes and we push the user to directly into the waiting users queue, then it's possible that the free operator, this invariant, that only one of them should be non-empty, this invariant might not be satisfied, because you are directly pushing it into the waiting queue even if there is some free operator, right? So that also is some implementation aspect that we need to worry about. So since waiting users dot front, and then we remove one waiting user from the list, we remove one free operator from the list, and we pair them up and push it into the busy operator list, right? So that is our first part. This condition is going to be this if part is going to be false if the waiting users dot empty is true, as well as free operators dot empty is also true. So this becomes false and false. That is the condition we want. That means waiting users is also empty and free operators is also empty. That means that all the operators are occupied, and the waiting users, there are no waiting users. So that means that we really don't need to do anything. Does that seem reasonable? That we don't need to do anything, and therefore else part doesn't contain anything. However, we still need to reduce the waiting time of individual parts, but that we need to do even if we have assigned some user to some operator to a user, right? So therefore that else part doesn't contain anything, but that if part comes, which reduce the waiting time of individual users. So that part that happens here actually. So this part okay, sorry about that. This for loop is going to be reducing the waiting time as we had earlier, so that part is okay. That is similar to the other one. It's going to be processing of the input, right? So this is similar to what we had inside the call center.cp first version, where we are processing the input. We are not processing the input here. We are processing the input here. So essentially, we create a waiting user. As you can see, that if it is empty, that is there are no free users, then only we are making a waiting user. So we are maintaining an invariant here that only one of them should be non-empty at any point in time. Otherwise, that is the free operator. So that also means that get free operator. Okay, so now I understand. So get free operator is going to return some value FOP, and that is guaranteed to give you a valid value because you are pushing the onus onto the user of your code, that the free operators dot empty check should be done by the user, right? So in this case, user means main, which is calling this function on the dot empty. So if it is dot empty, then I am just creating a waiting user and pushing it into the waiting queue. So when I reach get free operator, it is guaranteed that it will have at least one free operator, and therefore we don't need to worry about that inside the free operator, get free operator code, right? So this is what we were discussing, that the onus of whether stack is empty or not, whether you want to push it to the user of your library or you want to embed it inside the code of POP. So that is this is one good example of that. Any questions on this part? Sorry if I confused you a little bit, but I hope now things make sense, that get free operator is always guarded by this free operators dot empty in the second version. In the first version didn't do that, but in the second version this is guarded. So therefore, even if it doesn't process, I mean, here there is a guarantee that you will have a free operator. Any questions, concerns here? All right, so we will move ahead from here. I will come back to the slide then. Oh, actually we didn't run it on the second input. Let me just quickly do that. C++. Now we got out, take an input from call center, input 2. So yeah, I'm not going to go over probably this simulation, how that is working. I think that needs to be worked out, which I leave it to you. And at some inputs, multiple different operators, in this case 5, those are getting assigned to the incoming users. Then nothing is happening. That means only the time is reducing. There are no free operators. There are possibly waiting users. But as soon as a particular user is done with the mapping, then that user 0 was assigned to operator 0, so operator 0 became free, and therefore operator 0 could be assigned to the next user. After that, depending upon the waiting time, user 1 also got done at the same time. Therefore, operator 1, which was assigned to user 1, is now busy with the next waiting user, which is 7. 2 becomes free, and therefore 2 gets assigned to 8. Then 3, 7, 8 get done depending upon their waiting times. 4 continues, 6 continues, and then they get done at the end of the process. And then the processing stops. That means there is nothing to read from the input, as well as there are no users into this busy operators list, right? Everybody, the operators wait, and there are no waiting users also. All right, so I'll stop sharing this. If there are any questions, feel free to ask. Let's go back to our presentation. Right. So, multiple aspects of the application need to be usually glued together to create a working application. Some of that you will have encountered or you will encounter in your assignment, but by and large your assignments are going to be rather small. Those are not going to be typically called as large applications. But you can see that multiple actions need to be taken depending upon different kinds of, let's say, queries which are there, or different actions that need to be taken in different input formats that we specify, right? So in that sense, it's a small application, I should say, mini application. But your applications that you will develop will in industry are going to be much larger. Okay, so in this case, we just use the ADT queue from STL, but there are some implementation aspects that come into picture, especially when we are dealing with array-based implementation of queue, and that I would like to highlight. So let's say that you are given this array, and at this stage, let's say some elements, six elements have been added, and definitely I'm going to add those starting from index 0. Right? So 4 to 7 to 9, 5, these are added. Now I need to talk about whenever I am adding the next element, pushing the next element, where do I add? Right? So therefore, I need to keep track of that I am going to add it here. And therefore, maybe I'll keep track of either this index or this index. Correct? And similarly, when I'm removing an element, I need to keep track of this index. All right? So this is similar to, this part is similar to push and pop of the stack. But whereas this is going to be the head of the list where we are going to remove elements. Now, in case of array-based implementation, if I remove the element, which is always from the start of the queue, I need to then, this entry becomes free. So one way is I can move all these elements to the left so that, again, I maintain the inventory that queue, if a non-empty queue always starts at index 0. Is there any different way in which you can implement this such that this cost of shifting the elements reduces? Okay. Aniruddha says maintain start and index. Abhishek says circular queue. Sai Charan says circular queue. Mayank says we can consider start index of queue. Yes. So we can consider some sort of, we'll use both the ideas, start index, end index, and we'll make it circular. So that then we don't have to shift elements. We just maintain the start as well as end, and queue can actually be here. Okay. This can be the next queue starting from index 1 instead of index 0 to index, let's say, 5 in this case, right? So that becomes the queue. And as you push elements, it's possible that the queue might actually shift, push and pop elements. So the queue might be here starting from index 5 and ending at index, let's say, 9. And after that, if I push an element, then the index, the end index might actually come here if I make it circular. So these are two different ideas. Maintaining both start and end is one idea, and making it circular is another idea, and we are trying to combine these together. Let's understand this with some examples here, and then we'll get into more details maybe in the next class. So I insert 3. So for that, I need to know where the tail of the queue is, so that I maintain, so that I can update that. Then I remove, and remove need not give any element or index, it's always from the start, and therefore I need to maintain the front. Note that 4 element also exists in that array, in that memory location, but it is no longer valid because it is not within the window of front to back. Okay, so that is okay, that's fine. And this simple implementation we have in the queue implementation.c, which I will maybe explain. Okay, maybe I can explain now. Let me reshare the screen again. Right. So this is file queueimpl.c, which means that we are actually implementing this queue in C, right? And the number of, and the queue is implemented as an array. I'm defining, for which I am defining n to be a very large number suppose is large enough that it can accommodate all the values. Right? So this is a basic queue implementation. Works with total n inserts, does not work with n minus 1 inserts, right? So which means that the total number of insertions is limited by n, that is the size of the array, but it does not work with n minus 1 inserts, which it is not taking care of when the wraparound happens. When you are inserting n minus 1 elements, then the end index is going to come to the start. So I am going to show you a problematic code first, which will work as long as your queue is moving, right, in one direction. It's not really implemented as a circular queue. And n minus 1 removes followed by two inserts, right? As I was mentioning, it does maintain the start and the end, but it does not maintain the circular queue, and therefore this is going to work as long as the queue is moving, right? Only up to, let's say, n number of elements, in this case 1000. So let's understand this small code first. Again, this is very similar to our previous code where it did not work with the waiting users, the first implementation. Similarly here, we need not add circularity. First, let it work with only a moving queue where the start and end exists. Okay. So the main looks like this. We have a struct queue queue. This is C. I initialize the queue, right? So there is no constructor. And I print the empty queue, whatever. Then I insert some elements into the queue. It's a 0 to 9 elements I'm inserting, and I print it. I make sure that it is there. And while queue is not empty, I'm going to remove the elements from the queue and then print the queue, right? So this is a very simple program. Let's make sure that it works. I should compile it with GCC. So it just initialization of the queue is size 0, right? So that is okay. But the front and the back are also pointing to the same element 0. What does that mean? That doesn't mean that it has one element. It means that it is empty. So I need to maintain this invariant that front and back at the same index means that it is going to be an empty queue, which means that if I have non-zero elements, back should be greater than front. When I have inserted 0 to 9 elements, front is 0 and back is 10. Where does back point to? Back point to the next element where, I mean, next index where the next element needs to be inserted. It is not pointing to a valid element, and the same invariant needs to be maintained here, where therefore empty queue is defined by back is pointing to the same element as front index. Okay. So 0 to 9 is the printing of the list. Here it was empty, and that's why this empty line. And then I remove the elements and push it. And then finally, I also, when I have removed all the elements, the front has moved to the same position as the back, right? So this becomes a moving queue inside the array. Okay, there is a, let's go to the code. Let's quickly explain that in next 2 minutes. So our queue implementation has an array, the front and the back. As well as I'm maintaining the size, I don't really need to maintain this size as long as I maintain this front and back invariant properly, right? But the size I mostly require handy when I'm implementing it as a list, because I don't need to traverse here. Since it's an array based implementation, using the indices, I can just do a small calculation and find out what the size is, right? So therefore, the size is really not required here, but I'm maintaining it. Whenever there is a insert, I increase the variable. Whenever there is a removal, I reduce that variable. Queue initialization is front and back are zeros, and the size is also zero, right? So that's what we printed initially. Insertion into the queue is, if I am within the bounds, then I am going to insert it at where the back is currently pointing to, because back is pointing to the free entry, in the next free entry into the array, right? So that is where I insert E. Then I increment back, and size also I increment. Otherwise, I say that there is an overflow. In this case, there is no circularity. So there might be space in the queue, but it might still give an error. Space before front. Removal is kind of similar if there is no underflow, right? So therefore, then I reduce the queue size. That can be done later also. But wherever there is front, I am going to return that element, and then front needs to be incremented. Note that on insertion, back increments, on removal, front increments, right? Because that's why the queue is moving. And whether the queue is empty or not, that is defined by the size. Alternatively, you can think about how you will specify. If you don't have the size variable, how will you say that the queue is empty using only front and back? Essentially, that is going to be front equals equals back. In case of queue full, whether the queue size is going to be n, right? So that is going to be a condition for the queue being full in an array based implementation. This function might not make sense in a list based implementation. Printing is essentially you are going over the size and then just printing whatever is the element at queue front plus ii, right? Ii is the index. So that is our print implementation. Any questions on this one? Okay, so if there are no questions, we'll stop here and we can continue our discussion in the next class.